my baby and his friend. Sonny boy, please bring me some flowers on every decoration day.
She nice loving in every way. Lord, I got a woman. She nice loving in every way. You know she done died and left me. I had a blue on every decoration day.
I had a woman. She was nice and kind to me way. Long she died, she loved me. I sang the blues on every decoration day. Lord, I was standing round my baby's bedside. When my Lord taking my baby away.
Decoration Day 2018 from WBRN Radio and on the Boston Red Network. This is the 28th of May 2018. When our part is finished here, we will go to the commencement address at the Liberty University. For those, a little bit historical information there. It was founded by the late Reverend Falwell, and now is presided over by his son, Falwell Jr. Nonetheless, the commencement speaker was James Earl Carter. President Carter served in the 70s, ran for re-election in 1980, and was defeated by Ronald Wilson Reagan of California. And he recounts those days that he was in the White House, and he would get letters from a much more reactionary Liberty College on such things as the Panama Canal, no longer an issue, long, long forgotten. The Panama Canal, incidentally, was a place where John McCain was born. It was the Canal Zone at the time, and we'll talk a little bit about his book. This is a Veterans Day. And it's now called Memorial Day, made the transition from a Decoration Day, which it was at one time. And it came about by African-American soldiers of the Union Army that were honoring the Union Army. And that was the first Decoration Day. And it continued on, and then the name was changed. Professor Brett has that. And, in past presentations, we have talked about this. This is one of the shows that our former partner, Jerry Pippin, was a Vietnam vet. And he would do this program most of the time. We have taken it on, obviously, since his death 3 years ago. He died in 2015. It doesn't seem like that long, but we remember him boldly today and the politics. But Jimmy Carter had the type of politics as Jerry Pippin, although Jerry was a liberal. Jimmy Carter was a moderate, I guess he'd be called a liberal today. After he left office, the legacy continued for Jimmy Carter. He got involved in foreign policy, won a Nobel Peace Prize, and prior to that actually won a Nobel Peace Prize, but his involvement in foreign policy, his outspoken opposition to settlements on the West Bank and the various machinations of the Zionists in the Israeli state. He's not obviously liked there, but he has spoke his mind. In fact, he's known President Bashar al-Assad since he was a student, President al-Assad, since he was a medical student in California, of all things. And he's also familiar with Democratic Republic of Korea. So his commencement address, first of all, he's 94 years old. It noticed he's moving a little slower now, and they sort of panned the camera off while he moved up there. But once he got to the podium, he was the old Jimmy Carter. He spoke, 15, 20 minutes, something like that. They try to limit him now, even on the interviews, to 15 minutes, which is a good idea given his age. He had a melanoma, and he is in remission from his melanoma. Very serious melanoma there with President Carter. But when you make it to 94 years, you have definitely made a hallmark. He reminded people that he was from a little community actually outside of Plains, Georgia. I think Plains, Georgia now has 700 people. And his church there is a very small church, but on any given Sunday that he is there, 500 to 700 people appear, and they have to turn people away. The sanctuary cannot hold that many people. But Jimmy Carter enlisted in the Navy, and he left Plains. In fact, he was in the Navy for more than 10 years on a submarine in the latter part of World War II and into the 50s during the Korean War. He was also on a submarine, and when he was finished with his naval duty, he returned to farming peanuts. Later, he would run for governor of Georgia and would win, and from there, he came out of nowhere after Watergate as a quote-unquote fresh face, took off over Iowa. And I recall at that time, many of the evangelical Christians, in which he still counts himself, lined up behind Jimmy Carter. And he gave the famous Playboy interview. That was thought to be something sensational at the time. But he said he immediately dropped 15 points after giving the interview. What caused President Carter to lose the election? A number of things, but primarily the hostages, American hostages held in the embassy in Tehran. Every night, ABC News, that was before Fox got into business, would have America held hostage day 390 and so forth and so on. And that in itself, it was a fairly close race, in the sense that a few thousand votes here, it's one of those races, a few thousand votes there, and President Carter won re-election. Oregon was a very good example. There was a third-party candidate that is still around, a Republican that ran out, I don't think his name right now, but ran out of the state of Illinois as a third-party candidate. He was a moderate Republican. At the time, talked to him, John, almost got his name right there. Anyway, nonetheless, it was one of those elections that a lot of people voted for him, particularly in places like Oregon, which had started to be enlightened. That was a state that a man named Wayne Morse came out of, and he was a maverick in the Senate. Well, we'll go from there to another maverick. This is in the Washington Post, a review, and we'll do a formal review of Senator McCain's book here. This is a book that he's done a number of those with his former chief of staff, Mark Salter. Anyway, nonetheless, he's moved from being the maverick to the Bulworth. He's changed, and he's talking about history here, Senator McCain. Wasn't written for the votes, it was written for history. In an era of all capped tweets and anger, denunciation of supposed witch hunts, the senator from Arizona, his final book published to be on Tuesday, cast himself as a profile in courage. He highlights his advocacy for the Iraq troop surge when it was toxically unpopular in 2007, his decision to vote against repealing Obamacare, which was his most important legislative act to date, period. He finally tells his side of the 2008 Sarah Palin partnership with what time he has left the Maverick as And the population has worn through his career at sometimes more comfortable than at others. Is going to put the country first and tell the truth. He expresses regret that he didn't pick Joe Lieberman, right-wing Joe Lieberman, to run as his running mate. That was 10 years ago. His best friend, Sidney Lindsey Graham, enthusiastically endorsed the idea of bringing their colleague, who had been, he was the 2000 Democratic vice presidential nominee, almost made it to the White House. Al Gore put him on the ticket. Now, that was a mistake. He should never put Lieberman on the ticket. Lieberman has become an embarrassment ever since. But everyone else in McCain's circle have told him it would be a fatal divide. The GOP would sound vice. Yeah, I could reason for myself, he wrote, but my gut told me to ignore it, and I wish I had. He attributes the insufficient vetting of Palin, 44 and 2 years into her first term as the governor of Alaska, for his sulking about not being able to tap Lieberman. Taking the blame for her stumbles, he writes, she was a skilled amateur performer, asked to appear on Broadway twice a day. I wish he had grasped more fully with the Mahan Palin selection creed inside the GOP. It laid the groundwork for the ascendancy of DJ Trump a few years later. Trump emerged as a in the book when McCain, after the 2016 election, received a copy of a dossier detailing unverified allegations about the president's compiled by opposition research. He immediately turned it over to the FBI director, James Comey. And so the FBI could explore, was Trump compromised by the Russians? Anyone who knows it can go to hell. Anyone who doesn't like it can go to hell, he writes. And he also portrays the president as the outgrowth of a teleoptic shift in a party from which had just 10 years ago he was a standard bearer. Now he sometimes struggles to recognize it. Trump seems to vary from refusing to believe what the Russian president, V.I. Putin, is doing to just not caring about it. And some House Republicans investigating the Russia interference seem more preoccupied with their own conspiracy theories than with a real conspiracy by a foreign government to defraud the United States. Senator McCain repeatedly criticized conservative talk show host blowhards. He calls the House Freedom Caucus the Say No to Everything crowd. He says nativists need to be confronted and not ignored, are winked at, are quietly dismissed as kooks. He marked his primary challenge, Kim Trail Award, for attacking him as a champion of compromise. You're damn right, he responded. Former Trump aide Steve Bannon and Sebastian Gorka are self-proclaimed nationalist radicals. Bigger misfits haven't been seen in the White House since William Taft got stuck in his bathtub, he writes. It was all 300 pounds of Republican. Senator Rand Paul is another punching bag. The hawkish McCain faults a libertarian for falling prey to a conspiracy theory that he met with representatives of the Islamic State and for putting a hold on a vote to have Montenegro join NATO. Last year, he accused Paul of working for V.I. Putin by opposing expansion of the alliance. of all politicians self methodologies. This book is an effort to codify McCain's Maverick brand. He puts extra emphasis on his work across the aisle, including a 38-page chapter about working with a senator candidate, a liberal lion, of course, from Massachusetts on health care and immigration. And had they got that done, we'd be in a much better path. Now, critics say McCain always had been more straight talk than action, but sometimes those skeptics, especially on the left, want him to be someone he was not. He admits entertaining the idea of switching parties in 2001 when the Senate split 50-50. He still harbors some hard feelings about the bitter primary battle with G.W. Bush. The Democrats offered him a chair on the Armed Services Committee. I listened and was flattered, but insisted in every conversation my differences with the Democrats were more numerous than those I had with the current Republican orthodoxy. DJ Trump had not arrived. McCain said he prodded he's a proud Reagan Republican, not a Tea Party Republican, not a Bret Baier Republican, not a talk show or Fox News Republican, not an isolationist, protectionist boy. He's a immigrant bashing, scapegoating, get nothing useful done Republican. Not, as I am often dismissed by a self-declared real conservatives, a rhino Republican in name only. Really, though, he's always been a John McCain Republican. Even Reagan, who said he revered, didn't always get it right. In the book, McCain taunts his 1983 opposition to the deployment of Marines to Beirut. Was a very good idea because they were slaughtered. And his 1986 vote to override Reagan's veto of sanctions on the apartheid government in South Africa. So John McCain has had his moments, no doubt about it. He admits to some big mistakes, principal reason for invading Iraq with Saddam Hussein. Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction was wrong. The war with its cost in lives, treasury, and security can't be judged as anything other than a mistake, a very serious one. I'm glad he put that in the book. I have to accept my share of the blame. As in any memo, there are scores to settle. Lots, I told you so. McCain faults Barack Obama for not keeping a residual force in Iraq and not bombing Syria after Bashar al-Assad crossed the red line. The senator's critique of a current president is more sustained than any other, and for all our disagreements, I never doubted President Obama shared of his 75th year of bipartisan consensus that American leadership of the free world was a moral obligation. And you'll hear that and a practical necessity. He writes, I'm not sure what to make of Trump's convictions. Well, he's right about that one. He seems uninterested in a more character world leaders and their regimes. McCain writes, the appearance of toughness of reality shows, a facsimile of toughness seems to matter more than our values. Flattery secures his friendship, criticism is enmity. That's DJ Trump, that is. McCain was not a war hero because he was captured in North Vietnam. He would, however, like to be remembered for his long crusade against torture, his devotion to a media chapter to topics, and recounts apologies, apologizing a person to someone who suffered at his hands, American captive while in Libya over the objection to CIA station ship. He sided with the Democrats on the issues of 9/11 and recently declined to endorse the nomination of Jenna Hasper, a known torturer. After Trump spent years insisting that Barack Obama was born in Kenya and demanding to see his birth certificate, He forbid his staff from mentioning the Wright Reverend, Jeremiah Wright, in the controversy. In many other ways, his gestures seemed more impressive now. With that in mind, McCain reveres some of the changes, some of the charges against him that have ranked most. He's still recently insinuations that Obama's skin color was darkened in one of his campaign ads. A silly like was tossed at us regularly. His feeling remains hurt that John Lewis, a civil rights icon for whom he called a personal hero, invoked George Wallace and said McCain's campaign was creating the kind of charged political atmosphere that led to Birmingham's church bombing. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't forgive it, McCain said. Well, that campaign that John McCain with Sarah Palin was one of the most racist campaigns in American history, no doubt about that. Particularly came out of Sarah Palin and the rest of the Republicans. Now, I recall with John McCain, he was in the upper Midwest, and a woman was saying that Barack Obama was born in Kenya. And he said, no, that is incorrect, madam. And she kept insisting. He just snatched the mic from her. I thought he was literally going to slap her. That was vintage John McCain there. And, you know, some of the broad principles which he stood for there. But he inherited that volatile situation. If you recall, the primary was the most racist primary. The then Senator Barack Obama was running against Hillary the Monster Clinton of New York. And the monster and her sidekick, while Bill Clinton ran a very racist campaign. In fact, Rush Limbaugh exalted his voters in Mississippi to vote for the monster against Senator Obama. Of course, Senator Obama won the Mississippi primary. But those are some of the things there. This whole birth certificate thing, yes, it was a situation. But Barack Obama was not the type of campaigner as Hillary the Monster Clinton. He won in 2008 in the middle of a depression. Senator McCain had suspended his campaign to go do a miracle, but economics was not the senator's strong suit. And it turned up a fiasco. So thus, in the midst of a full-blown depression, Barack Obama takes his train to Philadelphia, Lincoln's train, and that coincides with this Decoration Day we're talking about, and with Senator McCain, who will be leaving us, no doubt, soon. So it's fitting and appropriate that we bring up Senator McCain and Jimmy Carter's pilgrimage to Liberty University, because both of these men were intertwined, Jimmy Carter being a naval officer in both World War II and in Korea, John McCain being in Vietnam, being captured. He was held as a prisoner in Hanoi, what they call the Hanoi Hilton. And then he was finally freed and returned to the U.S. and started a political career that spanned roughly 40 years or so there. I think he was at once in the House of Representatives. But nonetheless, he was, what, 3-4-term senator from Arizona and recently reelected in Arizona. Simon & Schuster is the person who will do a more proper review of John McCain's book, Good Times, Just Causes, Great Fights, and Other Appreciations. The Restless Wave, it's called. No doubt John McCain is of that. Let me do a couple other things, and we'll do the sports and go to Jimmy Carter of Plains, Georgia. See if any other headlines are blaring us. DJ Trump is now blaming Democrats for separating immigrant families at the border. In one of his tweets here, there's no law mandating the separation of children and parents. Only the policy of its own. So he says. Anyway, I guess DJ Trump decided he would appear. The Koreans and the South are meeting in preparatory with the U.S. officials. They are also meeting despite what is going on there. And NFL owners could learn from the history of more day. This is by DJ Dion. We'll have this on the Monday Morning Quarterback, which will be heard also on these channels, period. And this is from the Washington Post, the roots of the NFL. And incidentally, we did a program, the second episode of All About Sports. We talk about diversity in Major League Baseball in terms of managers and coaches, period. And did a very good job of that, in our opinion. It was on most of the outlets under All About Sports. We'll redo that on the Boston Red Moniker also. That will probably be later today or whatever, the program there. So it will talk about the dream of Jackie Robinson and Jackie Robinson reminding Major League Baseball in 1972 of their obligation to hire African-American managers, and we explore that, a dismal record that they had there. So this is one of the big things, period. So we'll talk a little bit about that in the Monday Morning Quarterback, and just kind of looking through some of these. President Bush, G.W. Bush, that is, G.H.W. Bush, I'm sorry, is in a hospital. He's 93 years old. In Maine, evidently, he's having some medical issues. But at 93, you're allowed to have medical issues. Let's just do the sports and wrap up our Decoration Day. We start this broadcast off, incidentally, with sort of a mix of Howlin' Wolf, John Lee Hooker, and a company with Decoration Day, the blues types. I thought that was appropriate, and we'll end it, of course, with Jimmy Carter. This is the final Game 7, which was held tonight in Boston. As usual, in these big money games, Mr. LeBron James led the Cleveland Cavaliers to a victory in Game 7, 87-79 win for Cleveland. They will advance to the NBA Finals. So now it's Golden State and the Rockets of Houston. They'll have their Game 7 also. James logged in 48 minutes. He finished with 35 points, 12 of 24 shooting with 15 rebounds and 9 assists. For the 8th straight year, James' team will represent the Eastern Conference in the final. But this could be one of his more memorable experiences, no doubt about that. James helped Cleveland overcome a 3-2 a series deficit, winning with twice, even after Kevin Love, who is out, had a concussion, and I don't know if he'll reappear later or not, but this is Cleveland. And we'll save the Major League Baseball scores for the Monday Morning Quarterback, which will come on this Monday morning or later here as we do this. But nonetheless, happy Memorial Day, and remember that we have All About Sports. That is our sports program that looks at the politics of sport, the sociology, we should say the social economic aspects of sports. We have to rewrite our marker there because we'll get into things. We also get into the NFL and ammunition from the coach of the Golden State Warriors. There's Steve Kerr. We'll talk a little bit about that on the Monday Morning Quarterback and appinge All About Sports to it so people will have it. Have a safe Decoration Memorial Day. We'll talk to you soon. Incidentally, Numbers Man on WBRN and the Boston Red Network is also there. That's our economics program for your perusal. The open source report will come shortly, sometime today. Good day.
The last few decades, swinging a hammer himself, building housing and supporting the poor through his foundation. I'm proud that Christians are uniting here today on issues where they agree rather than fighting over issues where they disagree. I remember as a high school student in the 1970s when many conservative Christians criticized Jimmy Carter for giving an interview to Playboy magazine and saying in that interview that he had sinned because he had lusted in his heart. He told me last night that he took a 15-point hit in the polls after saying that. Then it hit me this week that Jesus said in Matthew 5 that the old law said, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery already in his heart. And I realized that Jimmy Carter, in making that statement to the magazine, was making, so many decades ago, he was just making the same point that Jesus made in Matthew 5, that we are all sinners in our hearts, even if not by overt action. It saddens me today to think that so many conservative Christians attacked and demeaned Jimmy Carter in the 1970s for quoting Jesus Christ to a secular magazine. Finally, in 2002, President Carter was recognized for his lifetime of work towards peace, especially for his efforts undertaken during his post-presidential years, and he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. Now I ask that the Provost and President Carter join me at the podium. In recognition of President Carter's contribution to our nation and in acknowledgement of his peacemaking leadership across the globe, as well as Christian humanitarian activities among the least of these in all lands, and in recognition of his running the race with endurance into his ninth decade, with the power vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Liberty University, the Doctorate of Humanities is hereby conferred upon former President James Earl Carter, Jr., with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereunto. Yes, we have. And now to deliver our 45th, he just said, can I say a few words now? And now to deliver our 45th commencement address, please join me in welcoming the Honorable James Earl Carter, Jr.
Thank you very much, Jerry. I enjoyed that very much. I want to say, anybody who doesn't believe in prayer, just look at the rain coming down. If it hadn't been for prayer, I think we would have had rain this morning. So thank you for that. To Dr. Hawkins, who is retiring now as a provost of this great university, and to Secretary Carson, who's here, whom I've admired for a long time, the President of Falwell and all of his family, to the students who are graduating, to the parents who've supported them, and to all the rest of you. This is a wonderful crowd. Jerry told me before we came here that it's even bigger, I hate to say this, than it was last year. I don't know if President Trump will admit that or not, but to me it's pretty loud. Well, I'm truly grateful for the invitation to speak to this wonderful graduate class of a remarkable Christian university. I understand that there are 110,000 students enrolled, and I understand also that this year 20,000 or more are graduating, that 30,000 students who enrolled here are in the military, and that 27% of all those online are minority students, African Americans and others. This is the only way they can get an education. I want to thank Liberty University for offering that chance to all of them. Also, I've noticed that among the graduates, the youngest one is only 16 years old, and the oldest one is almost 90 years old. It's a female, and she doesn't want to know which one she is, because she doesn't want to know her age. But she's 4 years younger than I am. Well, the students also contribute each year more than almost a million hours of service to other people. I have to admit that I was somewhat surprised to be invited to come to Liberty to speak, and I want to thank President Falwell for making it possible for me to do so. I remember receiving a whole lot of letters from Liberty University when students and faculty when I was in the White House. Most of them were about my giving away our Panama Canal or forming what they considered to be an unnecessary Department of Education or normalizing diplomatic relations with the communist government of China. But those critical letters pretty well ended when the 1980 election results brought my involuntary retirement from the White House. And after that, I didn't get very many letters from Liberty. And I particularly appreciate the chance to come here today. President Falwell wanted me to say a few words about my background, and I already prepared some remarks that might duplicate some of the things he just said and correct a few minor mistakes that he made. I grew up on a peanut farm near Plains, Georgia, in a community called Archery that had about 50 families, almost all of whom were African-American, and so were my playmates. In fact, it was during segregation times, but the only distinction among us, the only rank among us, was whoever had caught the biggest fish recently or could run fastest or could pick the most cotton in one day. I left home when I was 17 years old, and the World War II was just beginning. This was in 1941. I went to Georgia Tech, where I joined the Navy and the Naval ROTC, and then I went on to the Naval Academy at Annapolis. And that's where I began to teach Bible lessons on Sunday. As a matter of fact, I taught the children of the families who were stationed there permanently. I later served as a submarine officer, and in my last duty at sea in the Pacific Ocean was during the Korean War. I served in the Navy for 11 years, then I came back to Plains, Georgia, and to a life of farming. One of the most memorable occasions I had then was to volunteer as what the Southern Baptist Convention called a pioneer missionary program. Every year I would go somewhere assigned by the Southern Baptist Convention to bring other people to Christ. One of my most memorable was to go to Massachusetts, and I had a leader there who was from Brooklyn, New York. He was a Cuban-American, and his name was Eloy Cruz. I would read a few verses from the Bible in Spanish, using a different vocabulary than the one I had used in the Navy, I might say. And then Eloy Cruz would give the plan of salvation to prospective followers of Christ. And he was remarkably successful in winning those souls to be Christians. When we got through with our assignment in Massachusetts and began to and got ready to leave to go back home, I asked Eloy Cruz, "What is the secret to your success in winning souls to Christ?" And he was a little embarrassed by my question. But then he finally said, "I try to have two loves in my heart. One love is for God. And the other love I have in my heart, I try, is for the person who happens to be in front of me at any particular time." That's a very profound statement, and one that I've remembered ever since that time. Since leaving the White House, I've been a professor at Emory University. I just finished my 36th year as a professor, and I still teach Sunday school at Maranatha Baptist Church in Plains, Georgia. Plains is a town of 700 people. It's grown a lot since I was a child. And we have 11 churches in town. So Maranatha is a very small church. We only have about 25 regular members, but when I teach the Bible classes every Sunday, we have several hundred visitors. Last Sunday, we had 700 visitors. We had to turn away 200 who couldn't get them in the church or in our classrooms. I have made a living writing, Jerry said, 29 books. I've written 32 books, and I gave him a copy of one of them last night so he could remember how many books I've written. And Rose and I are not yet quite married as long as he said. If we stay together for two more months, we'll celebrate our 72nd anniversary as a married couple. Rose and I found it, and we still work at the Carter Center. And we try to do two things. One is to promote peace, and the other one is to be a champion of human rights. This is a major operation, and we've had programs in 80 countries in the world trying to bring peace and democracy and freedom and a better life to people who live there. It's a big job. For instance, in Ethiopia, we trained almost 37,000 nurses. It took us 10 years to do it. And now when we go to Ethiopia to treat diseases like trachoma and others, we can treat as many as 10 million people in 5 days with the help of those 37,000 nurses. This is more people than live in the state of Virginia or the state of Georgia. We also try to eradicate some of these diseases, do away with them completely all over the world. In fact, at the Carter Center, we have the only organization on earth that analyzes every year, or rather constantly, every human illness to see which ones might be completely eliminated from one country or one region or eradicated from the entire earth. One of our programs is against guinea worm. Guinea worm is goes to a length of about almost a foot, almost a yard long, almost 36 inches long in human body after the human drinks filthy water from a stagnant pond. And then about a year later, that worm emerges from the body through an excruciatingly painful sore. And farmers can't go to the field and children can't go to school. To start with, we found 3.5 million cases of guinea worm in the world in 21 different countries. As of the beginning of this month, which is the last report I've had, we only have three cases in the whole world now in one country of Chad. As Jerry mentioned, for 35 years, Rose and I have volunteered to lead a habitat organization with a work project somewhere. One year, we're overseas, and the next year, we go to the United States. This year, we're going to be near South Bend, Indiana. Last year, we were in Canada. Our biggest project was in the Philippines a number of years ago. We had 14,000 other volunteers join me in Roseland, and in 5 days, we started and completed 293 homes for people who were desperately poor. The woman who would live in our house had three daughters, and before she got her new home, she and her daughters spent every night in an abandoned septic tank. They pulled a canvas cover over the top of it to keep the rain out. I understand that the resident students here at Liberty are building habitat houses here in Lynchburg, and I hope you'll keep up your work, because even all of those graduates will keep up that work, and the parents as well, and the professors as well, because Habitat really needs you every day. As a younger person, I lived during two serious crises, much worse than anything we face today. One was the Great Depression when I was a child growing up on a farm. And the second one was the Second World War. And when I faced difficult times, I remember the advice that my favorite school teacher used to give us, Miss Julia Coleman. She would tell us students, we must accommodate changing times, but cling to principles that never change. And I try to do that whenever I get in trouble. All of us Americans now have other crises to face. And let me mention just a few. I remember back in 1999, toward the end of that year, I was asked to make two major speeches. One was in Taiwan, and the other was in Oslo, Norway. And the subject I was assigned to talk about was, what is the greatest challenge that the world faces or will face during the new millennium? And I pointed out that it was the great disparity in wealth between the richest people and those who still work for a living with their families. Since then, this disparity in wealth has gotten much greater, both within nations and also between nations. Right now, for instance, eight people, six of them Americans, have controlled more wealth than the other 3.5 billion people, half of the world's total population. Recently I've changed my mind about the biggest challenge that the world faces. I think now it's a human rights problem, and it is the discrimination against women and girls in the world. Let me give you a couple of examples. There are about 160 million girls and women who are not living today, because their parents, in order to comply with laws or customs and to have just male sons, either kill their daughters by strangling them at birth, or they have the modern day ability to decide before the baby is born what it's going to be. And if the fetus is female, then they abort the child. Atlanta, where the Carter Center is located, is the greatest center for human trafficking or slavery in America. One reason is that we have the most busiest airport in the world for passengers. And a lot of our passengers come from the Southern Hemisphere. And a girl who is brown skin or black skin can be sold, according to the New York Times, to a brothel owner for about $1,000. And the brothel owner makes about $35,000 for these forced brothel prostitutes. Also, the last time we did a check in our military, it was found that there are 16,000 cases of sexual abuse every year in the U.S. military, probably one of the finest organizations on earth. The portion of people in prison has also skyrocketed in recent days. There's more than 7 times as many Americans in prison as there were when I left the White House. 7 times as many, more than any other country on earth. And now we also know that the partisan divisions and the racial division in our country have never are becoming deeper and deeper. In fact, all our religions are also divided. Protestant, Catholic, Jewish, Islamic, I'm sure Hinduism and Buddhism. On two occasions you might be interested in knowing, in 1981, I brought about 40 of the top Southern Baptists together at the Carter Center in Atlanta. I was just out of the White House, and when I asked them to come, they came. Seven of those, mostly men who came, would become presidents of a Southern Baptist Convention. And we tried, but failed, to resolve the differences between us and keep all the Baptists together. One of the differences we couldn't solve was the status or equal status of women. I'm glad to say that our common faith in worshiping Jesus Christ, though, is slowly bringing us back together. And Jerry and I talked last night about the possibility that he and I and all of you, I hope, will work as much as we can to unify Christians in the world, and particularly Baptists ought to come together as friends and not be alienated one from another. More recently, the threat of nuclear war has become more acute. America has abandoned its leadership, as you know, as a champion of a clean and healthy environment. Broad confidence in our public officials has gone down, and we citizens have tended to lose faith in ourselves and in each other. We've also lost our support and our commitment to those principles that never change. But I'm very glad to say that most of you have chosen the unchangeable premises or principles of Christianity. Only one time in human history have people tried to adopt these really high principles that never change, that are worthy of adopting, and that was after the death of more than 60 million people in the Second World War, and also after the Holocaust that was perpetrated, orchestrated by Adolf Hitler. I monitored those proceedings from the deck of my first ship to which I was assigned after I finished Annapolis. And when the United Nations was established, to make sure that there was never any more armed conflict between people, and that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted to assure that everybody would be treated equally and would have justice. We know that the United Nations has failed to bring peace, and universal human rights have not been realized. However, we also know that the modern ability to travel rapidly and instant communications, along with the wide use of social media, have brought an enormous step to a truly global society for the first time. We evangelical Christians, and I consider myself to be one of them, one of you, must use this world coming together and communicating instantly with each other to promote the word of gospel about Jesus Christ. Theologian Reinhold Niebuhr, one of my favorites, used these words. And he said, the sad duty of politics is to establish justice in a sinful world. This in itself would be a great achievement, but we Christians know there's one step much greater than just bringing justice to a society, and that is to promote the use of agape love, self-sacrificial love among people. When I became president, and before I was inaugurated, when I was elected, I was given a brief by the military leaders of our country. And I learned, really for the first time, that if I permitted a nuclear war, the use of atomic weapons, that the arsenals of the Soviet Union and the United States alone, if they were used in that kind of war, would end the ability of all human beings and animals to survive because of the direct explosions, the atomic fallout, and the covering of the skies by dark clouds of smoke and debris from the nuclear devices. No human being and no animals could survive a nuclear war. We now still have that great responsibility and threat, and we have to share it with 7 or 8 other countries, which you know, Russia, China, Great Britain, France, England, Israel, Pakistan, and India. And maybe, we don't know for sure, North Korea. With this threat to human existence, what then can you and I do about it? For a long time, humans had to contend with animals, and we depended on our, just for survival, and we depended on our speed, our agility, our strength to survive in competition with animals. We know that for several generations now, human intelligence and the weapons that we have developed will permit us to prevail over other animals. So what is that left to do? How can we prevail? How can we as human beings? One of the things we have to learn is how to get along, to do good for one another, and to get along with our potential enemies instead of how we can prevail in combat. In other words, just follow the mandates of the Prince of Peace. Just learning how to live even with our enemies in peace is what Jesus taught. And that will be our only sense for survival in the future. We don't need enemies to fight. Nor do we need inferior people whom we can dominate. Let me just quote one verse of Scripture in Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither male or female. There is neither slave nor master. For you are all one in Jesus Christ. So far, we Americans, down through history, have had a hard time adjusting to this concept of equality. We fought the Civil War, the war between the states, that finally ended slavery. In the 1920s and then 40 years later, we had a struggle in our country of granting white women, and then 40 years later, black women as well, of just the right to vote. And more recently, we have been struggling to end racial segregation. Even now, some of us are still struggling to accept the fact that all people are equal in the eyes of God. As when I was president, in the Navy and also when I was president, I want the United States to be strong enough so we never have to prove that we are strong. But there are attributes of a superpower that go beyond military strength. It's the same as those of a person. Our nation should be known as a champion of peace. Our nation should be known as a champion of equality. Our nation should be known as a champion of human rights. We should also be admired for our generosity to other people in need and other moral values. In other words, for those principles that never change. There's no reason why the United States of America can epitomize these high virtues. Despite all these challenges that I've already outlined, maybe to your discouragement, as a Christian, I believe that the ultimate fate of human beings will be good, with God's love prevailing. As new graduates, you're probably now blessed with the maximum freedom that you will ever know. In the past, your parents and others have had a major influence over your lives. And in the future, years ahead, you'll also have a major influence from the job that you accept or the career that you choose. And also, I would say, from the husband or wife that you might choose. So right now, in fact, you have a maximum opportunity. Use three gifts that God gives every one of us: life, freedom, and in effect, a guarantee that every single one of us will have enough talent and enough opportunity to live a successful or completely successful life as judged by God. We may not be rich. We may not live to be an old person. We may not have many loyal friends. But neither did Jesus have any of those things. But he lived a perfect life, without any interference from anybody else, all by ourselves. We have complete freedom to make a judgment. This is the kind of person every one of us decides. This is the kind of person I choose to be. We decide whether we tell the truth or benefit from telling lies. We're the ones that decide, do I hate or am I filled with love? We're the ones who decide, do I think only about myself or do I care for others? We ourselves make these decisions and no one else. There are no limits to our ambition as a human being. And we have available to us, every one of us, constant contact with God in heaven, the creator of a universe and the creator of each one of us. How many of us decide ahead of time when we're going to be born, or where we'll be born, or who our parents will be, or what our native intelligence level will be? You see, through prayer, we can have constant contact day or night with our Creator, who knows everything and can do anything. We have a perfect example to follow if we're in doubt. We just have to remember the perfect life of Jesus Christ. Thank you very much, and congratulations to all of you.